O Lord, how shall I meet you? How welcome you aright. That's the question posed by one of the Advent hymns in our hymnal. O Lord, how shall I meet you? That question could be asked in a number of different senses. O Lord, how shall I meet you? How shall I meet you when I come to your house and you come to me in worship? When you come to me in word and sacrament, gathered with my fellow believers, how should I meet you? O Lord, how shall I meet you? That's a question that, given the time of year we're in, certainly leads us to think about how we should meet the Lord when he comes to us as that Savior in Bethlehem. How should I meet you as you come at Christmas, dear Jesus? How should I meet you as you come as the Savior who comes to rescue me from my sin? O Lord, how shall I meet you? You've been paying attention to our previous Advent services on Wednesdays and on Sundays. You probably know the sense I'm going to ask next. O Lord, how am I going to meet you when you come again in your glory? When you come on those clouds with angels and archangels and that trumpet that's going to bring this world to an end. Lord, how shall I meet you on that day? Oh Lord, how shall I meet you? That question certainly does have a number of different senses in which it can be asked. But when you stop and you think about that question of how we should meet the Lord, there's really just one answer to all of those different senses. Oh Lord, how shall I meet you? I'll think about how we meet him when he comes to us in worship. Don't we begin by saying, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit? And to help you think about the significance of that, think about how people prepared for when Jesus came to this earth to win that salvation. Think about how he came in that flesh and how people were told to prepare for it. John the Baptist, the forerunner of the Savior, said to people, "Repent and be baptized. Be washed in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." Lord, how shall I meet you when you come again? How am I going to be saved on that terrible judgment day? Well, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, right? How shall I meet the Lord? How shall I prepare for his coming to me? I prepare through baptism. And the reason why baptism is an answer to all of those different questions of how should I prepare to meet the Lord is because there in baptism, God comes to meet us and he comes to prepare us for all of those other comings. There in baptism, God comes in that special way to create faith, to make us his children. I'd like you to keep that thought in mind as we listen to a lesson from John that talks about our Savior coming as the one who would redeem the world. Lesson from John chapter 3. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness of what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than the light, because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come into the light, lest his works should be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. This is the word of the Lord. We'll continue with our next hymn, hymn 5, verses 1, 2, and 3.